All right. Good evening, everybody. How are you tonight, Larry?
Doing fine, thanks. Chris, how are you?
I'm good. I think we're going to talk about the election of 1880, right?
Correct.
Now, this is the first election since after Reconstruction. I believe it's the first election since, or the first election they have in direct electors. Is this the first election that there's two generals on the ballot?
I'm sorry, there's two what?
Union generals.
There are actually five Union generals on the ballot.
Five, okay. And then, let's see, for major issues, we had the tariff, and then there was the Asian Exclusion Act, was that right?
The Asian Exclusion Act, yeah. The Greenback Economic Policy, the and civil servants, civil service. How and i.e. the spoils system. How do you get appointments after you're elected? Also, Reconstruction was a major issue because the Republican Party was still in favor of keeping up with freedmen's rights to vote and everything, while the Democratic Party, but the South was starting to funnel into the Jim Crow legislations to stop freemen from voting. Ultimately, you're going to see poll taxes and literacy taxes and other ways to turn off the vote down the line, not so much in this election. Most of the major issues between the Republican and the Democratic parties were not that great. A lot of this was personality, and a lot of this was the Republicans as still the winners of the Civil War against the Democrats, who a lot of people believe caused the Civil War. Garfield refused to run on the bloody shirt coattails based on, he did not accuse the Democrats during the campaign of causing the Civil War. As you said, there were both the Republican and the Democratic parties were led by generals. Garfield was a general, and Winfield Scott Hancock, who was the Democratic candidate, was a general. Weaver, who was the Greenback Party candidate, was a general. Dow, who was the Prohibition candidate party, was a general from Maine. And Phelps, who was the leader of the Anti-Masonic Party, was also a Civil War Northern Union general. So when I look at the issues, other than the actual Greenback issue, which was very important, there's not that much difference between Garfield's stand and Hancock's stand.
Okay. So take us back. So Hayes is leaving office.
Hayes made an agreement when he accepted the nomination in 1876, and also when they agreed that he was going to be put in office, he agreed that he was only going to be a one-term president.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Huh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, it was when Hayes had no intentions of running again in 1880, though if I'm not mistaken, there was one elector who voted for him in one of the early ballots in the Republican convention, but he did not want the job again.
So on the Republican side, we have a familiar face trying to return in Ulysses Grant.
That's correct. And Grant, for the first 35 ballots, is the leader. The most he ended up getting was in the 33rd ballot, was 312 votes. Now, you needed 370 to win. Grant was always was between 304 and 310 or 312 in all 36 ballots, but that was it. Grant was supported by Senator Roscoe Conkling of New York, and that may have been one of the issues against him, because Conkling was what was called a stalwart in the Republican Party. He favored not civil service for jobs, but he favored Andrew Jackson's old spoil system to the victor belong the spoils. James Blaine, who finished second in every ballot except the 36th, was a half-breed, and he was in favor of some civil service reform to get a meritocracy, getting the best person for the job. Hancock, on the Democratic side, was okay with civil service reform and did not make it a major issue.
Hancock did not make it a major issue.
Correct. The closest major issue between Hancock and Garfield was the tariff. And even that wasn't major. What happened was Garfield was in favor of a protective tariff. U.S. Manufacturers could compete with cheaper goods that were being made in Europe and sent over to the country. So Hancock on the Democratic plank stated they wanted a tariff for economic means. Now, there was no real definition of what the economic means were. Could it mean that the tariff was just on certain manufactured goods? Could it mean that the tariff was there to help Southern manufacturers as opposed to Northern manufacturers? I would guess that that was one of the reasons, but there's not really that much background on it. I think the more interesting issue in the whole campaign, and that issue is the greenbacks, because the third party presidential candidate Weaver ran on what's called a greenback party. Both Hancock and the Democrats and Garfield and the Republicans wanted money to go back on the gold standard.
Huh. So there was no difference between the two parties on that issue?
No major difference, correct.
Okay. And I'm going to just explain to people just quickly what that does when you put from the gold standard to the greenback as far as economically.
Yes. During the Civil War, there was a shortage of gold and silver. So what the Union did was they issued paper money called greenbacks. Now, those greenbacks were not backed by precious metal. They were backed by bonds printed in the United from through the U.S. Treasury, and also some private bonds from various banks in the states. So the difference is when you're not on a standard where your money is backed by precious metal, you can print money based on legislation. So the only thing that backs that money is the face value of a bond created by the Treasury Department. Therefore, there's more money in the economy. And when there's more money in the economy, it usually leads to an inflation, which it did during the war and after the war. But it also frees up money for farmers and small businessmen to actually borrow money to be able to put in crops, to be able to get machinery, or to be able to increase their profits and whatever they're going to do.
So inflation's not always a bad thing then, right?
No, inflation can be a good thing in times. But once what the gold standard did was part of the gold standard being re-emplaced was that they were going to take the greenbacks partially or totally off the table. They were going to pull it out and only back money by gold and not back it by federal fiat by printing bonds. So it would be it would cut inflation, but it would be harder for little businessmen and small farmers to get money because they don't have the backing to get the loans anymore. So that's the issue. And I think Wheeler just wasn't the man to put it forth. I mean, he ran a creditable third party candidacy. He won about, 3 or 4% of the vote, if I'm not mistaken. And there were actually three states where his vote could have affected the outcome of the states. New Jersey. I'm sorry, Chris.
No, I was going to say, let's hold off on that right there for a second. Let's cover all the candidates first.
Okay. Well, we've covered all the candidates. We haven't covered how they got to be candidates.
Okay. Yeah, let's do that one first and come back on all the returns.
Okay.
All right, so we covered the Republicans, right?
Okay. What happened during the Republican convention, and we spoke about Grant, and the two major candidates opposing Grant at the beginning were James G. Blaine, who was a senator from Maine and also a former Secretary of State, and John T. Sherman, who was a senator from Ohio and was General William Sherman's brother. They were the big three. Now, the two of them together had more votes than Grant in all, in the first 35 electoral, 35 counts. And this is a long convention. It went to 36 votes. Neither Blaine nor Sherman trusted each other, so they never combined their votes. Ultimately, Garfield had one vote, two votes. He had basically no votes until the 34th ballot, when he won 17 votes. Neither Sherman nor Blaine wanted Grant, but neither of them wanted to pull out for the other one, and they both had they both thought Garfield was an excellent choice. So on the after the 35th vote, they all suggested that their voters go for Garfield, and a lot of the other voters, Edwards, a lot of the favorite sons also went for Garfield at that point. So on the 36th ballot, Garfield got 399 votes, which was 19 more than the 370 he needed. Grant got 306 votes. Sherman got 5 votes. Blaine got about 40 votes, but Garfield obviously won. Now, we mentioned Senator Conkling of New York, who was supporting Grant the whole way. Now, Garfield wanted to balance the ticket by taking one of Conkling's people from the stalwarts as his vice presidential candidate. So the first one they offered it to was Levy Morton, and Conklin told him not to do it, and he refused the nomination. So the second one he offered it to it was Chester A. Arthur, who was also, he was a New York State Civil War general in charge of drafting and provisions and that type of thing. And even though Conkling told him not to accept it, Arthur did accept the nomination. So we had Garfield and Arthur as the Republican candidates.
Garfield, okay.
Now, should we go into the Democratic?
I was kind of interested in the Democrats. Who all was, I can't remember, who all was involved in that one again?
There were basically three major players in the Democratic candidate. There was Winfred Scott Hancock, who led the whole way but did not get enough. The second man was a senator from Delaware named Bayard, B-A-Y-A-R-D. He was a conservative Democrat, so really he was off the mainstream of the Democratic Party, which even though most of them were from the South, or many of them were from the South, they were more liberal than Bayard. And the third and most important candidate, though he didn't get many votes at all, but there were a lot of other Democratic candidates holding spaces for him, was Samuel Tilden. Now, Tilden ran in the 1876 election against Rutherford B. Hayes and actually won the popular vote. But did not take the Electoral College. But it was thrown into the House of Representatives, but before the House of Representatives actually voted, the two sides got together. Tilden was okay waiving his rights to the presidency, quote unquote, if the Reconstruction was rolled back and federal troops were withdrawn from the South, which Hayes agreed to. So a lot of people, a lot of Democrats thought that Tilden deserved the nomination again in 1880, and they thought he would be a very good candidate. And an aside, when I used to live in New York City, I was a member of the Samuel J. Tilden Reform Democratic Club. We met on Irving Place, which was in the Gramercy Park area. But right off the bat, within the second ballot, Tilden decided he didn't want to run. So basically, most of the Democrats went for Hancock, a lot of it because of his military service. But not all of it, a lot of it because he was a name, he was famous, a hero. But Bayard was not really in step with the majority of the Democratic Party. So on the third ballot, Hancock won sufficient ballots to win the nomination, but they declared him the winner by unanimity afterwards. Everybody dropped out, including Bayard, and Hancock won by unanimous vote. Hancock picked a representative from Indiana named Edwards. Don't know that much about him, but he was to help the state. Though he did not, the Democrats did not win Indiana, and Weaver, who the third-party Green Bay candidate, who was a general from Indiana, also did not win Indiana. So obviously, Garfield won Indiana, but Indiana was one of those states where if Weaver wasn't in there and his votes went for Hancock, Hancock could have taken Indiana, but it was unlikely because most of Weaver's support were disgruntled Republicans.
Okay, that is interesting there.
Go
ahead. You're fine.
Okay, so then the other two states in the election that Weaver could have affected. One was New Jersey, where mm-hmm. Weaver got approximately 12,000 votes, and Hancock won New Jersey by a little less than 10,000 votes or a little more than 10,000 votes. That one could have gone into Garfield's column. And if it was, then Garfield would have won every state north of Maryland, Delaware.
Oh, wow.
So this is the first election that the Democrats have captured the solid South. They won every single state in the South, including California. California actually had 6 electoral votes. 5 went for Hancock and 1 went for Garfield. And California was the third state that Weaver affected, because without Weaver, California could have gone for Garfield also.
That's a pretty close thing there. What was the total electoral vote?
For Garfield?
Well, for all of them.
Well, Weaver and the other two didn't get any electoral votes. It was, if you hang on 1 second, I can get an exact figure. So
okay. Sorry, that's all right.
The electoral vote, the election itself was close in the popular votes, but the electoral votes really weren't. Garfield took all the major states, and 2 biggest states at the time were New York and Pennsylvania. Garfield got 214 electoral votes, and Scott got 155. States that were very close. I don't know if I mentioned it, but the popular vote, Garfield won the popular vote by less than 10,000 votes. He won New York by less than 2,100 votes.
Oh, wow.
And that was a lot of that was because of his issues with Conkling. So even, Conkling made New York very close, but not close enough that Weaver could have changed anything.
Okay, yes, I see the math there on that one. How many electoral votes did New York have?
214 to 155.
And how many did the state of New York have?
30-something, 31, I think.
Okay.
And Pennsylvania had 26 or 27, maybe 28.
Directly choosing the electors, did that change anything? And
it really didn't change anything. Okay. It was just a matter of how the electors were chosen. In past elections, if you voted for the presidential candidate, the state or the party would select the electors. In this one, by voting for the presidential candidate, you were directly voting for a slate of electors in the state. So once Garfield won New York, the New York electors were pledged to Garfield I'd have to look at state law at the time, but they were pledged to Garfield probably for the first two, I'm sorry, for, yeah, for the first, for the whole time. I'm confusing electors with the convention delegates.
They're still not constitutionally bound, correct?
Correct. But so once the states were called, and once the states were called for Garfield and Hancock and none for the other three candidates, Garfield was declared the president-elect. And then once the official count made him president on March 4th of 1881.
Okay, so let's go through. We haven't went through our issues yet, have we?
Right. Well, as I said, well, we talked about the greenback issue. We talked about the tariffs.
Okay, we've already covered the tariffs.
We've talked a little about Reconstruction.
Okay.
Those the only other major issue was civil service, and we've talked about that too. Even though Garfield supported the meritocracy and wanted the change of civil service, Garfield, as most of you know, was assassinated within his first month of office. He was assassinated by a man named Charles Guiteau, who was a stalwart supporter of Conkling, who... because he supported Conkling and because the Republicans won, he wanted an ambassadorship. He was totally non-qualified for an ambassadorship, and he was told he was non-qualified, and that was the reason why he gave for assassinating Garfield. The interesting point was that even though Chester Arthur, the vice president, was a Conkling Republican, he ended up supporting civil service reform to get the best people in the job. Well, you know, it's not the same as civil services is today, but it's a lot closer than civil service than the old spoil system prior to Garfield's election and Arthur's ascension to the presidency. That was the really major issue, and it wasn't a major issue amongst the Democrats. It was really a major issue amongst the Republicans. And now, ultimately, if Conkling could have, if the stalwarts were more popular outside of New York, Grant might have been a three-term president.
Wow. Did Grant, you think he, since 1876, did he plan this comeback, or what do you think was going through his mind?
He definitely planned the comeback. I don't think he was thrilled with Hayes, but Hayes was not there anymore. And I know that Grant and Blaine didn't get along. And, Sherman maybe could have gotten along with Grant, but Sherman was too short on ballots for the most part. Blaine was very close to Grant, and maybe at the beginning in some of the balloting, Sherman could have put Grant over the top, but at that point, Sherman thought that he was the best man for the presidency, and basically, until the 33rd ballot, he was actually the 34th and the 35th ballot. He was starting to think that maybe we need a compromise candidate. Grant had issues. Grant was popular because he was a military man, but there were major scandals during this presidency. And there were major problems with the Indian Bureau. There was also the buying of there were bond scandals. There were land scandals in the Black Hills. Grant was an unpopular president, but as a military leader, he could still gain the backing of many people on the Republican Party.
Let's see here. Southerners, I thought we covered this about the states. So let's go through their mind. I mean, having to pick all these generals from the North.
Well, the answer is, don't forget, many of these generals from the North served in the South at some point, talking about Sherman, talking about other Northern generals who served in California, who served in Arizona, who served in New Mexico. There were many Northern generals who served in the South and after secession left to go back to their to Northern states.
I don't think the name Sherman would be too popular though in the South.
No, he wasn't, but Sherman was very popular in the South before the Civil War. Sherman served in Louisiana. He served in the West. He was not anti-Southern. He just wanted to defeat them and bring them back into the country. His brother was a lot more anti-Southern than he was.
Yes, they just the name of
I mean Hancock, but don't forget, the Democratic Party split in the 1860 election. There was the Northern Democrats ran Stephen A. Douglas, and the Southern Democrats ran Breckinridge. Lincoln, with the Republicans, though he won a majority of the Electoral College, basically in a four-person election, only won 37-38% of the popular vote.
Yeah, I can't wait till we get into that one, because when you break down some of these states, that he's like, man, if you combine the Democratic vote and the Union Party vote,
right.
He don't even get close.
Right. I mean, there were, as we go deeper and deeper into the election cycles, there are less and less third parties. Most of the elections between 1884 and 1912 had no effective third parties. Actually, Weaver and the Greenbacks were not an effective third party in 1880. There were no effective third parties in 1876. A lot of smaller parties would combine in with the Republicans or in with the Democrats to give them the majority and would not run as a third party. It wasn't really until Teddy Roosevelt formed the Bull Moose Party in the 1912 election, where another major candidate ran on a third party and may very well have thrown the election to Woodrow Wilson.
That is very true. What if we covered anything else covered on this one?
Well, we discussed the Asian Exclusion Acts, which came about first one was in 1880, I believe. The major thing in this election, and what I think was involved here more than anything else, was Garfield more popular than Hancock? Was Hancock more popular than Garfield?
You know, I was wondering that too, because it seems like, and it may just be how he's portrayed it, and he really wasn't like this in real life, but Hancock just seems so likable.
Well, Hancock was likable for his troops, but, you know, he was a military man. Right. And you had, Grant had two terms. You had Hayes having a turn. you know, maybe it was, you know, Garfield, though he was the general, was in intelligence more than actual command. I mean, he did command, but, you know, he was intelligence. It was a little bit different. And about, and it was about time when everybody was running on the fact that they were a Civil War veteran. Weaver's vice presidential candidate was a Civil War veteran. He was a Confederate Civil War veteran, but he was a Civil War veteran.
Right.
Dow and Phelps, the two generals leading the Prohibition and Anti-Masonic parties, were Civil War generals. Arthur was a Civil War general, though a state general. Cleveland was not, but Benjamin Harrison was a Civil War general. William McKinley wasn't a general, but he was a Civil War officer. He was a major. The first, other than Cleveland and other than Andrew Johnson, the first president with no roots to the Civil War was Teddy Roosevelt. And he fought in the Spanish-American War.
It's true, yeah. Yeah, you're going to be loaded up with, I mean, you have to be, you know, Civil War vets from...
Right. Years. I mean, there was an old joke it was a Southern joke, so hopefully I'm not insulting anybody, but there were four men running for office, and one of the men said, well, I lost my leg at Chickamauga. The second man said, I lost my eye and hand at Gettysburg. The third man said, I lost my arm at Chancellorsville. The fourth man said, well, I didn't know that we all had to have a Civil War injury to run for this race, but I'm the most ruptured man amongst the four of us.
I've never heard that one.
Well, I mean, yeah, it was just, it was a show that at some point, you know, military men don't always win. And when we talked about this in our last post for the 1948 election, Dewey was not a military man. And Truman, though he was a military man, he was a major in artillery in World War I, was not really known as a military man. And neither Thurman nor Wallace were military men. But, but here you're in a culture of the military. And as I mentioned before, one of the first things Garfield refused to run was on the bloody shirt, the fact that the Democrats were the cause of the Civil War. So they're trying to get away from military.
Or by healing type candidate.
Right. Yeah. What I think the most important thing to come out of this election is the solid Democratic South.
Still pretty much switched parties, but it's still pretty much been solid one way or another ever since.
Right. Hancock won every single Southern state. If you count California as a Southern state, he lost one elector in California. He won five, lost one. The only state north of he won Delaware and Maryland, which were border states during the Civil War, and he won New Jersey. And he won New Jersey basically because in all probability, Weaver took the state away from Garfield. Now the other issue is, and we mentioned it briefly, and obviously we're going to mention it much more in later elections, is Jim Crow rearing its head in the South. The 15th Amendment, one of the three anti-slavery amendments, or one of the three post-Civil War amendments stated that a person could not be disenfranchised, but it said that a person could not be disenfranchised on the grounds of race. So yeah, you don't disenfranchise them on the grounds of race. You find out other ways to disenfranchise them. We needed an election to knock out the poll tax in the 1900s. The literacy tests. You didn't have to be able to read and write in English. You had to be able to read and write in whatever language the literacy inspector in some of the districts in the South wanted you to read and write in. I've heard Texas many times. Texas had a large German population, and many times blacks were forced to read and write in German to be qualified.
Pardon? Said, oh Lord.
Yeah, and there was one district somewhere in the South that the blacks were made to read and write in Norwegian because the elector was a Norwegian immigrant, or a family of Norwegian immigrants. So that, you know, you did everything possible to knock off the free man ballots, to knock the free man out of their elected positions. You'll see that very few representatives and senators are Republicans at this time already. There are still local elections. There are local towns where you may have some Republicans. There were a lot of union loyalists in the South, but they were Democrats. You know, they were loyalist Democrats for the most part. And now Mississippi is probably the worst state, but now the Democrats, now the white Southern Democrats are now trying to retake the states, and they have converted. This is the first election that there's a solid South. Hayes against Tilden, there were three Southern states that voted for Hayes, Florida being one of them, but not in this election. I mean, I think those are the major points to be taken up in the 1880 election.
Yeah, is there anything you want to add to this one? I mean, I can't think of anything I've got for it.
I think the reason we took this election, the reason we wanted to do this second, at least in my mind, is just because of the fact that it was the first election with the solid Democratic South.
Right, yes.
You know, there were major issues, but unless you're into economics, greenbacks and tariffs are not going to thrill you. So the interesting part of this election was the demographics. What was happening in the country? The country was basically being divided again, and it will ultimately start having states' rights, lost causism, the solid South, and it will be divided again. And ultimately, it's going to cause in the 19-teens and the 1920s and the 1930s the great Negro migration into the northern cities.
Is that when it started, in the teens and 20s?
Excuse me?
Is that when it began? You said the teens and 20s?
The teens and 20s, yeah. That's when it really began. People realized that they weren't going to get a fair deal. At the very beginning, there were a couple, there was some civil rights legislation in the 1860s after the Civil War. The Supreme Court upheld some decisions against the Solid South in favor of Republican voting and that type of thing, but it was getting less and less. And then finally, in 1898, and there's a lot of interest in this case. It was called the case of Plessy versus Ferguson. And to study the actual case, it's fascinating, but we really can't do that here. It was a streetcar case. And basically what it held was in public facilities, separate but equal facilities for blacks and whites and Asians and other races were constitutional, as long as they were separate but equal. So there was a long line of cases between 1898 and 1954, Brown versus the Board of Ed Topeka, which was a case in Kansas, that in order for blacks to get rights in the South, they had to prove that the cases involved separate but unequal. And in that case, a black was able to go to a law school in Texas or South Carolina because the white law school or the state white law school was a lot different from the state colored law school. In Brown versus Board of Ed Topeka, when Justice Warren, who was a former attorney general and governor of California, and the court ruled that separate but equal is inherently unequal. And that's when everything started to change again. There were other issues. There were issues about fair housing and that type of thing that happened in the 1940s. But this is the start of all of it. This is where the black codes came in. This is where the Ku Klux Klan and other groups terrorized blacks or intimidated blacks and stopping them from voting. This is when people tried to register to vote and were not allowed to vote because of either poll tax or literacy taxes or various other rules. And this is where, you know, it's straight from this election to Black Lives Matter, at least in a progression.
That's an interesting take or perspective you just put on that. I never thought about that.
And that's why that people are trying to, some black people today are trying to claim reparations from slavery.
Well, all right, Larry, unless you got anything to add on that one, I'm going to cut this one. And
I think I'm good.
Okay. And